Politicians, pundits, and academics may have no trouble picking sides in the healthcare debate if only it were so easy for investors. Here to tell us what healthcare reform means to drug maker profits and how it'll affect consolidation in the industry, Jeffrey Cross, chief executive and co-founder of Crystal Research, which conducts independent industry research. Jeff previously covered healthcare and the drug industry at a number of Wall Street firms. And Jeff, it is always good to have you here. Welcome back to Bloomberg. Let us talk a bit about M&A to start off with, because three of the seven biggest either pharma or biotech deals of all time have taken place in the past year. They've been announced anyway. And we just saw, of course, the deal between Johnson & Johnson and Elan last week. Right. How is the financial and economic crisis changing the game effectively for drug makers, especially as it concerns acquisitions?
Well, it's forcing them to move more aggressively into acquisitions and joint ventures. They have one giant asset, and that's cash, one giant liability, that's time. So you're seeing more than ever pharmaceutical companies looking to basically shorten that gap. And they're doing it by looking outside themselves. They're looking to other companies' pipelines, and we've maintained for the past 2 years that we are going to continue to see M&A accelerate, and we have, not only in pharmaceuticals, but in generics with Teva buying Bayer and medical devices across the board.
Well, what's so interesting, though, is that for the first time in 5 years, pharmaceuticals are actually the most active industry in M&A over the first 6 months of this year.
Correct.
Oh, go back 5 years, it's been banking, financials, right, et cetera. How long can we expect this to continue? Are pharmaceuticals effectively unique because of the cash flow that they have at a time like this?
They are unique. They're in a very strong cash position, a very low debt position, and some of the companies that they're looking at, some of the biotech companies, for instance, a lot of them are down to, you know, other than the big ones, less than a year of cash, less than 6 months of cash. So pharmaceutical companies, much like Johnson & Johnson did when they bought Senecor or some of the other biotech companies being acquired, pharmaceutical companies are looking to biotechnology and saying, hey, this isn't our strong fold, but a lot of these companies have got very interesting products. We've got the cash to develop them. That valuation goes low enough, we pounce on it, and that's exactly what they're doing.
Now, lawmakers, of course, on Capitol Hill debating over health care reform. Does this M&A frenzy continue through that?
The M&A frenzy will continue through that. A lot of the big issues with health care reform are how many years of exclusivity will remain for the biologics. There was $287 billion spent on pharmaceuticals over the past 2007, and $40 billion of that was biologics or biotechnology products. So Teva has been pushing very hard to get 7 years exclusivity instead of 12 to 14. Obama came out and said they endorse 7 years, and that will help get generic versions of biologicals on the market a lot sooner. Teva is the big beneficiary from that. Also Ceba through the Sandoz generic division at that company.
A couple of questions there, though. First of all, how big are the stakes in that debate over exclusivity? And secondly, if Teva is going to be the winner one way or another, who's going to be the big loser?
Yeah. Tens of billions of dollars are at stake from the biologics as to who can get it out there. You're talking about, you know, whether you're going to have a product go off market and have tons of competition, or you're talking about whether it's going to have a little. Biologics are very difficult to do outright. What's at stake? Billions of dollars. The losers there are probably going to be a lot of the insurance companies. The winners there are going to be generic companies that can do biologics, or large cap pharma companies with generic divisions can do large biologics.
Let's talk a bit about the bottom line in the healthcare debate. How successfully do you think the drug makers were in heading off perhaps a little more pressure from the administration by announcing that $80 billion Medicare agreement?
Well, I think they're very successful because they're filling that donut hole, the $2,700 to $6,500 gap for Medicaid, Medicare recipients that right now they have to pay. $80 billion is a big concession, but it's dependent on a successful approval of a health care plan by the administration. And I think that was a big move by them and a big forward step to make to show that they want to have prescription drugs be part of the answer. Keep in mind something very important. Of a dollar spent on health care, less than 10 cents of that is a prescription drug. Prescription drugs are part of the answer, not part of the problem.
Right. Okay. I've heard that before. But what is the risk that the reorganization of health care insurance is going to turn the focus back to the drug makers? You're right, though. They do make up a small part of the total health care spend, but they're so big, they make such an easy target.
They're an easy target, but I think when the U.S. citizens learn the facts, for instance, when Herceptin was approved in Europe, it was available for 4 years, but it's 4 years before any of the people in England were able to get access to that drug, which means thousands of people who had breast cancer died. You want access to medication, you want access to affordable medication, you have to utilize the medication if you want to survive. So it is part of the solution, and they are a big target, but their profitability has really waned, so they're less of a big target, and they're giving a huge concession, so they're even less of a big target now.
Jeff, I'm afraid we have to cut it off because we have some breaking news. That's Jeff Cross, CEO of Crystal Research. Jeff, thank you.